That's a way to kick off a worship service, man. Woo! Thanks, guys. Great job. Great job. Good morning. How are you today? That means you're better than you look. I mean, you're as good as you look, all right? Absolutely wonderful. Thanks for being here. What a gorgeous day out. Man, after temperatures getting up into the 90s, nice cool down for the weekend. It's beautiful. So thank you for sharing this beautiful day with us at New Hope. If you are visiting with us, you're a guest today for the very first time. It's our honor, our privilege to have you here. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to take one, fill it out, drop it in the offering when it comes by. We make a promise. We're not going to harass you on the phone or come pound on your door, but through the mail, we'll send you information that tells you about New Hope Church, answer most of your questions, we hope. And if you want more information, then we're happy to bother you after that. But we'd love to get that from you today. Hey, just I want to send out kudos. Any of you high school kids in here, you can pass this on in the high school service later. But kudos to Morgan Claiborne today. She got up early this morning and came and led worship for the 8 o'clock service. Chris Bishop, our youth pastor, who normally leads for us since the beginning of the year, they're out of town. They're on a family vacation and attending a graduation back east for part of his wife's family. And so she is one of our high school juniors or seniors? Senior. And she had her prom last night. And she got up early and got here before 8 o'clock to lead us in worship. So kudos to Morgan Claiborne. She did a great job. In fact, she just might be Chris's permanent replacement, all right, because she is so much better looking than Chris is. And it was great having her in there. Also, our associate pastor is out of town. Mark Addis is not only out of town, he's out of the country. He's in Indonesia today. He's already worshiped the Lord this morning. Sent me a text, told me what a great time. Said the church that he attended there asked him to stand and introduce himself and tell him where he was from. And so he said he was from New Hope Church in Clovis. So New Hope has made it all the way to Indonesia. All right, so that's good stuff. So be praying for him. He'll be home the end of the week. Let me highlight a few things that are coming up, and then we'll get to our prayer requests and then get engaged in our worship today. The big board over here, I think Mark Addis talked about this a few weeks ago when he preached. This is loving our neighbor. I got to come up with a better word for this. It's not a program of New Hope. It's not a ministry of New Hope. I read some material, was exposed to something a little over 2 years ago. We kind of did a soft launch. It didn't take real well. Since Mark has come on staff, he's gotten excited about this. Envision in your mind a tic-tac-toe form, okay? How many squares do you have? You got 9 squares, all right? Picture where you live right in the middle, that middle square, all right? And then imagine how many of your neighbors do you know that live in front, on the side, and in back of you? How many of them do you know? The national average is 1.5. 1.5. Because we go in and out of our houses. We don't do what families used to do, and that is hang out in the front yard. Okay, we go in our house, we close our doors, we kind of shut the world out till we have to get back at it again the next day. Or if we're going to get out, we go out in our backyard, and our fences now are taller than we stand. Okay, so we can't peek over and see what's going on. And so this is not, there's not a date, there's not a Bible study for this, there's not, what this is all about is saying, hey, encouraging you, would you be willing to be somebody who obeys one of the 2 commandments? No, I have not forgotten there are 10 commandments. But Jesus said you can summarize all 10 with 2. And where I am in my stage of life, less is better. 2 commandments. Love the Lord your God with all your heart. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. And I know over the years people have asked the question, who in the heck's my neighbor? Let me just leave it at its most basic definition. The tic-tac-toe board? Those are your neighbors. We can answer it in a bigger format, but that's where it starts. Most basic. So here's what the initiative, this is the word I got to come up because I don't like the word initiative. It sounds political. So this idea, this groundswell idea that I hope takes over in New Hope Church and churches all around the country is this idea that we're gonna love our neighbor, and it starts with this. I'm going to make a concerted effort a couple of times a week just to get out and walk a little bit around my neighborhood. And as I walk by a house where my neighbor lives, I'm going to pray for them. I may not know their name. I may not know what's going on, but I'm simply going to pray for them. And when we move from praying for them, we're going to pray then also for ourselves. God, give us opportunities to meet our neighbor. One guy at a meeting I went to shared his testimony. He was Middle East Indian, moved to this country, believer in Jesus Christ. And he said, didn't know one of my neighbors. Really had never seen any of my neighbors. And he said, so I started walking just a few doors each direction and praying for my neighbors. And then I took my chair from the backyard and I put it on the front porch. And I started sitting out on my front porch, and as people went by, I would smile and wave at them. And he said, for the first couple of weeks, I'd smile and wave at them, and they'd just kind of look at me, and they would drive on. And he said, after a couple of weeks, then they started waving. He said, then after about a month, one of the guys stopped, got out of his car, walked up to my front porch and said, what are you doing this for? And he said, I'm just trying to find a way to meet my neighbors. And I wanted to start out with just y'all knowing that I was friendly. I'm okay. And the guy said, you want to get to know your neighbors? I said, yeah. I really want to get to know you, and I want to love you. And he said, that started a relationship with that one neighbor. And he said, after a couple of months, we had a barbecue together. And he said, during that barbecue, he said, no, really, tell me, well, why are you doing this? And he said, anything I could do to help you, I'm here for. And he said, no, really. And then he said, I told him, the God that I worship tells me I have two things to do. Love him, love you. And his neighbor looked at him and said, what time's your church service this Sunday? I want to meet that God. I don't know about you. That's pretty impressive to me, all right? And there's no formula. There's no plan. You don't make things happen. You just put yourself in a place that you see what God does. And so there's a little book. It's a lousy title. If I was titling this book, this is not a title I would give it because it doesn't excite me. Neighborhood Initiative and the Love of God. That doesn't just jump out and catch me on fire. But what's in the book is really good. And Mark and I are going to be talking about this a little bit more and more as time goes by. But if you want to take this home, here's the deal. Notice, it's skinny. Okay? It's not a fat book. It's a skinny book. All right? Also, notice, there are some blank pages. So it's even skinnier. All right? I can tell you, there's not any pictures. Okay? So that's a bummer. But if you want, it's up here. It's by this board. And this board is up here because this is identifying the neighborhoods where people at New Hope live, okay? And that you're saying, yeah, I'm going to start praying for my neighbor. That you're going to, I don't know how this is going to work, but yeah, I want to be a part of this. So what you do is you come up here and you take one of these pins up here, and black, white, or red doesn't make any difference. They're just stick pins, all right? Just take one out, find where you live. Shelly and I, I put this on here a little bit ago. We're here. Where'd I go? Yeah, it is. We're on the edge. Always been a little edgy. Okay. Did somebody take my pin out? It's not that one. Oh, right there. Yeah, it's white. You're right. It is. It's a white pin. It's right there. And you're right. We're the farthest one out at the moment. All right. We're right there. And so we're going to, so you just come up, find your place and say, yeah, I don't mind starting to pray for my neighbors and see, and just put your place there. And churches in all over Clovis are doing this right now. And so we're going to be a part of it. And if you'd like the book, it's here. There's a basket right here. There's some money in it, but this is not for you to take money out of. It's for you to put money in. The way we sell books around here is this way, free 5 or 10. Okay, this book I think is normally $12.95. We got it cheaper. So if you can't afford it but you want to read it, take it. If you can afford it, pay $5. If you want to help somebody else who can't afford it, $10. All right, does that work? All right, and you're on your honor system. Okay, I'm not going to check you out.
Where do you put your pin if you're not?
If you're not, put it on the cork board. Okay, right next to it. Okay, all right. We'll have to get you included on the map. We'll get a little addenda Okay, we'll get Mark to do that. All right, so that's the love our neighbor. Tonight there is a citywide worship service at Mountain View Church. The month of May is the National Day of Prayer, National Weekend of Prayer. Prayer is a big emphasis in the month of May, and there's a citywide time of prayer and worship tonight at 5 o'clock over at Mountain View Church, and any and everybody is welcome. Pasta Feed is next Sunday evening here at the church, fundraiser for our fifth and sixth graders who are going to be going to camp. You may purchase tickets outside in the pavilion after the service today. They're $5 a person, maximum $20 for a family. So if you've got five, you get a deal, all right? It's $20 instead of 25. You got six, you get a bigger deal, all right? Now, here's what family means, parents and kids, okay? This does not mean the nieces and the nephews and the in-laws, all right? That doesn't all go under one umbrella. You got that one figured out? Okay, moving right along. Next Sunday is Baptism Sunday also. We're baptizing 13 between our 9:15 and our 10:45 service. These are from children to adults who've accepted Christ and want to take this public profession of faith in baptism. And so come and join us next Sunday for those two events. There are still baby bottles out there for you to pick up to be engaged in the Pregnancy Care Center fundraiser from Mother's Day to Father's Day. Parents, take it home. Let your kids help fill it up with change. Put some dollar bills in it, put some check in it, whatever you want, bring it back by Father's Day, and this all goes to help Pregnancy Care Center as they provide necessary resources for young mothers not expecting to be expectant. And so be a participant. It's a wonderful thing. Some prayer requests. Mike Dermanuel had hip replacement surgery on Thursday, and he went home Friday, so he's doing very well. We're grateful for that. Was handed one this morning. Barbara Newman, which is a sister of Earl Rowland, was admitted to Kaiser Hospital last night with an irregular heartbeat, if you'd remember to pray for her. I want to say thank you to so many in our church who over the last month you have been heavily engaged in helping to serve during receptions following memorial services, and you did it again this past Friday for one of our own, Arlene Brobst, who the week before on Friday went home to be with the Lord. She's worshiping in a way you and I cannot even imagine this morning. And here's what I got to tell you, man. Jim and Arlene walked their faith all the way through the valley of the shadows. Absolutely impressive. What an example to me of what I hope as I face it again in my own family or I face it with my own self. What a wonderful example that the two of those left for us. So thank you for your help. They were in service today. Jim was, and his daughter and his son. So continue to pray for God's care and comfort in their lives. So just a couple of updates besides those that we've already mentioned in the past. Just found out about this. I don't even have all the details, but this coming Thursday night at People's Church is a fundraising event for, I always forget what to call it, horses. Heart of the Horses. Heart of the Horses. Jack Hanna's going to be with the Sons of the San Joaquin. I've been informed it very possibly, it's intended to be the very last public performance of the Sons of the San Joaquin as a group, all right? Health issues impacting Jack's brother, and so this is kind of the last scheduled event for them as a group. Heart of the Horse is a wonderful, wonderful program and outreach. Guy directs it, but he's got a lot of support, Jack Hanna being one of those. Jack was just with us in our senior luncheon last week, so you can go online, I'm sure, and find out more information about it, but that would be this Thursday night, a fundraiser for Heart of the Horses. I'm going to ask our ushers to come wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Gentlemen, would you come? Please join with me as we pray. Our Father, I thank you for the life that you offer to share with us every moment of every day. I thank you, Father, that there's nothing in this world that ever catches you by surprise, though on occasion it catches us unprepared. And so, Father, that's why it is so vital that we daily make the choice to walk in a healthy relationship with you. It's the reason that we need to be consistent with that choice so that we are prepared when those unexpected circumstances of life occur. It's the reason we need each other. You didn't design us to be Christians alone, but you created your church so that we can be encouraged together, we can be accountable together, we can grow together. And then, Father, you challenge us in your word to think on these things, to meditate, to contemplate, so that, Father, when tough moments of life come, when low moments of life come, when surprising moments of life come, we're not destroyed. Might be knocked down, as Paul said, but not destroyed. And so, Father, we trust you this morning to help us recognize our need to be hungry and thirsty for the things of Christ. that there be a desire in us to walk in intimate companionship with you every day. Father, we trust you with the needs that we've expressed, those that are in the hospital, those recovering from surgery, those who are still going through treatment for Bobby Clark. Lord, he's got a new appointment with a brand new doctor up in Stanford, and they've got some new things that they've had some success with for the challenges that Bobby faces. And so thank you for the hope that's given to Bob. And Father, I know that his hope is not in the doctors or in a plan, but his hope is in you. But thank you for how you're using this at this moment in his life. And we pray for wisdom as the doctors continue to use discernment and make decisions for him. So we just trust those needs to you. For the privilege of giving and sharing today, Father, we say thanks. In the incredible name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. Today, so I invite you, if you brought your biblical hymnal with you today, turn to Psalm 63, because we're going to be reading from there in just a few minutes. Psalm 63. I want to open with verse 1, Psalm 63, 1, and then we'll read the rest of it in a moment. David wrote these words, "O God, you are my God, and earnestly I seek you." Quick question. Two quick questions. First one is the God that we have sung about this morning, is he your God? I don't mean your neighbor's God. I don't mean your spouse's God. I don't mean your parents' God. Is he yours? Nobody can sign you up for this thing. You must choose new birth. You must choose new life. Number two is the second line in that song. Does it describe how you came here this morning? Earnestly, I seek you. Is that the desire of your heart? If it wasn't when you arrived, has the worship time brought you to a place to say, okay, I'm ready to get serious about this thing? David said, "My soul thirsts for you. My body longs for you." There was a small boy, about 5. He was sent to bed by his dad. 5 minutes after dad had tucked his boy into bed, the boy yells from his room, "Dad!" Sound familiar? Any of you who've raised kids? "What?" "I'm thirsty. Can you bring me a drink of water?" "No, you had your chance. Lights out." 5 minutes later, "Dad! What?" "I'm thirsty. Can you bring me a drink of water?" "I told you no, and if you ask again, I'll have to spank you." 5 minutes later, "Dad! What? When you come in to spank me, would you bring me a drink of water?" Have you ever been that thirsty? You see, the problem is that many people who are not thirsty for God, there are many who are not thirsty for spiritual life. They know there's something within them that needs to be satisfied, but they're not looking in a spiritual direction for that satisfaction. They're looking everywhere else. And be assured, the world that you and I live in, it understands the thirst that the residents of this world have. Look at every commercial on television. Look at almost any advertisement in a magazine. The billboards down the road, and they are appealing to those areas of our life that they think they can satisfy. They are looking for our areas of hunger and thirst, and they're doing their best to fill the gap. Let me hit one that stands out more than any of them that illustrates what I'm talking about. There's an advertisement, TV and the radio, that promotes a particular beer. Yeah, there we go. There we go. Dos Equis. I'm just seeing how many of you knew Dos Equis, all right? I was just checking. Way to go, Jerry. The ad features Jonathan Goldsmith, who's described to us as the world's most interesting man. And he ends his advertisement with those words, "Stay thirsty, my friends. Stay thirsty." You see, the world understands, and I suggest to you today, Satan understands, that we as human beings are looking for fulfillment. We're looking for ways to satisfy our life. And before that we can have a healthy, growing relationship with God, you and I must recognize we have a thirst, and that thirst is for God. And once we have come to God, we must have this ongoing desire to be satisfied by God. We can actually say, along with Goldsmith, "Stay thirsty, my friend. Stay thirsty." We must cry out as David did in Psalm 63, "God, my soul thirsts for you, my body longs for you." In a dry and weary land where there is no water. David lived in the same world you and I live in. And David was wise enough to know there's nothing in this world that satisfies the thirst of his soul and the thirst of his life. There's nothing this world offers that can satisfy him. It's a barren land. How easy it is for us, I think, to fall into a trap of ritual religion. So many Christians know little of a vital, fresh, day-by-day relationship with the Lord. I did not say that many in church have an inactive relationship. I just said it is not vital and fresh every single day. I think we Christians have never been more active ever in the history of the church than we are in the 21st century. The tyranny of the urgent is no theoretical problem. There's many a believer who jumps off the Sunday treadmill activities only to hop onto the weekday treadmill of meetings and appointments and functions and rehearsals and practices and sporting events and clubs and engagements and banquets and studies and committees and retreats. I think I heartily agree with a professor of Dallas Theological Seminary by the name of Howard Hendricks, who a few years ago said, "Much of our religious activity today is nothing more than a cheap anesthetic to deaden the pain of an empty life." I see this all the time. People who say, "Tim, I know Jesus." And when the least little bitty calamity comes up, their world is devastated. And I say, "Tell me about your prayer life." "Yeah, I prayed to receive Jesus." "No, tell me about your prayer life. It's not a once and done prayer. It's not, I read through the Bible 1 year, I don't ever have to pick it up again." "No, tell me about your spiritual life. How's it doing? I mean, if I ask you what you had for breakfast, lunch, and dinner the last 24 hours, I know every man in the room could tell me. Okay? You could tell me what you ate. If I ask you, hey, how's your physical exercise going? You could tell me the last time you exercised." And I understand a lot of y'all do the once and done thing, okay? We tend to live that way. But this is a hard truth for us to ponder, but it's reality. As a pastor, one of the greatest desires of my heart is to help all of us cultivate this consistent and meaningful walk with the Lord Jesus, one that is not filled with ups and downs, but one that has with it a consistent chart of growth and a healthy relationship with Jesus Christ. You see, this is a relationship that thrives without needing to be pumped up or recharged with an endless succession of activities. I would wish that we all might know our Lord in such a significant way that this divine companionship, this healthy vertical relationship, becomes a steady, serene, daily communion. We must find ways to live beyond the grind of religion and live in a healthy companionship with Jesus. Last night I had the privilege of officiating another wedding. Young lady who grew up in our church, Jenna Thaxter. Kind of hard to imagine that she's old enough to be married, huh? Kind of hard enough to imagine that she's teaching school in Kerman. Okay? She's graduated, got her degree, and got her teaching credential, and now she's married. And last night was fun. I mean, it's the celebration of a wedding ceremony. As Kyle and Jenna became one. But guys, this whole subject of marriage is also referred to throughout the decades as an institution of marriage. And I know a lot of marriages that are institutional. I do. You probably know, say, you might be living in one. You see, you had the wedding celebration where you signed the legal document, and don't misunderstand me, I think marriage ought to be legal. But you put your name on a dotted line, you sign a legal document, you're thrilled with the excitement of your wedding day, and then after your wedding day, there's no longer this divine intimate companionship. There is simply the institution of marriage. And when bumps and difficulties and challenges arise, it's no reason that marriage is devastated. The same principle applies in our walk with Jesus Christ, this divine companionship that He wants to have with us. If all we are practicing is the institution of religion, the ritual of worship, then when the little bumps in the road come, we're hurt. And when the crises of life come, we are destroyed. A.W. Tozier, a brilliant author and pastor of another generation. In fact, it's a book I'd hardly recommend to you. You can still get it. I'm pretty sure you probably can download it for free. It's probably one of those books you could download at no charge. It's not very big, but it is powerful, all right? Not as hard to read as C.S. Lewis, but just as deep, okay? He's going to take you just as deep. Listen to what Tozier said a few decades ago. He said, I want deliberately to encourage this mighty longing for God. The lack of it has brought us, the church, to our present low estate. The stiff and wooden quality about our religious lives is a result of a lack of holy desire. Complacency is a deadly foe to all spiritual growth. Acute desire must be present, or there will be no manifestation of Christ to His people. He waits to be wanted. Do you want God? Too bad that with many of us, God has to wait so long, so very, very long. Every age has its own characteristics. Right now, we are in the age of religious complexity. The simplicity that is in Christ is merely found in us. In its stead are programs, methods, organizations, and a world of nervous activities which occupy time and attention. The hollowness of our worship, the severe limitation of this world that marks our promotional methods all testify to that we are in this day. We know God only imperfectly and the peace of God scarcely at all. What an indictment. But it is so true. Psalm 63 is King David's song about what it means to have a desperate longing for God. What it means to be fully satisfied. Not only to have a longing, but then to find that satisfaction in Christ alone. It's not a song of activity. It is a song of quietness. David didn't write a march to compel busy feet, but a sonnet to woo our thirsty souls. Believe it or not, a lot of people don't know they're thirsty. They know they're dissatisfied, but they don't know they're thirsty. You may not feel a deep longing cultivated in an ongoing personal interaction with God, and that's probably because we have dulled our spiritual senses with activity in life, career activity, social activity, religious activity. And if so, our first response may be to slow down our pace. Maybe a key to get us in a place that we recognize our thirst is simplify. I got to be honest. I don't hear many Arlene Brope's testimony around. When I met with Arlene's family, though I've known Arlene and Jim for the last 5 years, visited with them on many, many occasions, till I sat down in the living room of their home and began to ask Jim and his kids about his wife and their mother. So you find out things about people you wouldn't find out any otherwise. Here's a woman who watched, and I'm not here to slam TV right now, okay? But here's a woman I asked what were her favorite TV programs. She rarely ever turned it on. And I said, well, tell me what she did then with her days. She spent time with the grandkids, and she baked, and she kept our house. And Tim, every day, 4 o'clock, right on the money, no matter what she was doing, she stopped. She grabbed her Bible. She turned on instrumental hymn music. And she said, in the chair that I was sitting in, she sits in that chair, and for the next hour or more, nothing interrupts her. Her and God every day. Whew. That's the fourth step of this less, more lifestyle we've been talking about this year. We make a choice. We're consistent with the choice. We're accountable to the choice. And number four, we contemplate the truth of God. And she sits and she thinks and she reads and she lets God speak to her heart. This 63rd song is a song for us when you and I are tired of the rat race of life and the rat race of religion. These are two rare occurrences today and even rarer people in our society. David wrote this song not while serving in the tabernacle, but David wrote this in the isolation of the rugged wilderness south of Jerusalem. Some of the previous psalms we've looked at were David in the wilderness when he was running from Saul before David became king. This one was written after David had been king for several years. And though he had been used to living in the palace, he now finds himself as king on the run back in the wilderness. See, just because you may reach your pinnacle of life doesn't mean you'll never go backwards. Doesn't mean you'll never have problems again. Doesn't mean that that is what satisfies your soul. So David had reached the top of the heap, and he finds himself now in desperate situations again. But what satisfied him before he ever got to the top of the heap is going to be that which will satisfy him once he's been there and slid back down again. Try to imagine this situation in your mind for just a moment. You are startled in the middle of the night with the ringing of your phone. Now, that happened to me last night. Now, my son Chad lives in Tennessee. It's 3 hours later there than it is here. He knows I don't normally go to bed till, you know, probably close to 11 o'clock. So it was 10:38 our time. It just so happens that last night I went to bed before 10 o'clock. So I hear my phone ring by the side of my bed. I look over. It is my son. You know, as a parent, you know. And I'm thinking, okay, that means it's about 1 o'clock where he is, okay? I'm thinking, what's wrong? So I answer my phone. Yes, son. Hey, Dad, what do you think about that stuff that's going on back in California in the educational system with the boys getting dressed in the girls' locker room? Now, that is true, and we will come back to that on another Sunday. This is an issue we're going to have to address as a community, all right? And I have a whole lot to say about it, okay? And so I'll share that with you down the road. But right now, this is what my... Because they're moving back next week, and he's got interviews, you know, in Clovis Unified, all right? So, Dad, I said, son, it's 10:38. Yeah. Oh, Dad, were you sleeping? I said, no, I woke up to answer the phone. And... So I said, you know, we'll talk about this more in daylight hours, and I love you, and I'll see you in a week, okay? But you know what it's like to get those calls. Your heart is pounding as you think something must be terribly wrong. In this story, what I'm asking you to realize is that on the other end of the phone is a familiar voice of a trusted family friend. His voice is frantic. He tells you that your adult son is coming over with some of his gang members to kill you and you need to get out of your house immediately. The sad thing is you're not totally surprised. You've been estranged from your son for a while. You've not spoken to him for a few years because he has murdered another one of your sons, his half-brother. He killed him in revenge because your son had raped their sister, your daughter. The son was always a hothead growing up. He was prone to violence. You really believe he's coming in anger and hatred to murder you. You jump out of your bed. You grab your car keys. You jump in the car and you get out as fast as you can. You have no wallet, no credit card, no cash, only the clothes on your back. You cannot go to another family member's house because you don't want to put their lives in danger. You have already been to the police and they say there's nothing we can do until they actually do something to you. Your mind is racing, you're frantic, and what do you do and where do you go? You are tired of driving and you pull into a rest area to get some rest. And in that moment of quietness, your situation comes crashing down around your shoulders. What a shambles your life is in. You've had a daughter raped by her half-brother. You have a son murdered by his half-brother. This son is out to kill you, his dad, and you think, God, where did I go wrong? And then it hits you. You started this chain of reactions by that affair that you had years ago. You opened this door for sin to ravage your family, and much of the blame you realize falls at your doorstep. How would you feel that night? Devastated? Sad? Suicidal? The background of Psalm 63 is David's own tragic life. You can read this whole story if you'd like in 2 Samuel chapter 11 through 18. Don't have time to do that today, but you can read that. David wrote this psalm as he was fleeing from his son Absalom, who was seeking to murder him and take over the kingdom. When David committed adultery with Bathsheba, he opened this door for his family, and he did it. His son Amnon raped his own half-sister, Tamar. Absalom, in revenge for his sister's rape, killed Amnon. For years, David banished him, refused to forgive him, and even to speak to him. Now Absalom has gathered an army, and he's out to kill his father David and take over his throne. David flees for his life, not knowing if he's going to lose everything, including his life. Do you think you could find any soul satisfaction in God at a moment like that? See, that's the background. And I think that's so very important to understand that background as we read these words. What would you think if I said, not only could you, but I will show you exactly how to find soul satisfaction? I know that you could, because David found soul satisfaction in this situation. It's found in Psalm 63. Let's read the whole chapter. It is not very long. Oh God, you are my God, and earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My body longs for you. In this one verse, spirit, soul, and body is defined there. Oh God, earnestly I seek you. How do we find God? Spiritually. The Bible says God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. His spirit hunts, his soul thirsts, and his body longs in a dry and weary land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you, how long? As long as I live. And in your name I will lift up my hands. My soul will be satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you. On my bed, I remember you. I think, or in three other versions, it translates it, I meditate on you through the watches of the night and the dark nights of the soul. God, I think about you. Because you are my help, I will sing in the shadow of your wings. I stay close to you. Your right hand upholds me. They who seek my face will be destroyed. They will go down to the depths of the earth. They will be given over to the sword. They will become food for jackals. He's talking about his own son. But the keen, that's me, the keen will rejoice in you, O God. All who swear by God's name will praise him, while the mouths of liars will be silenced. John Piper said, God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. Is God getting much glory? If you're not satisfied, the answer is no. C.S. Lewis writes, our Lord finds our desires not too strong, but too weak. We are half-hearted creatures fooling around with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered to us. We are like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in the slum because we cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We are far too easily pleased. David made five decisions in this chapter that enables him to find satisfaction with God. Five decisions. This won't take me long. Number one. In verse 2, David decided to create a mental picture of the Lord. I have seen you in the sanctuary. Had he? No. Okay? He'd not been to the sanctuary here. Remember, David worshipped in a tabernacle. So when he uses this term, he's not talking about the earthly tabernacle. He's talking about God's sanctuary. David hadn't been there. He's still alive. But he imagined this in his mind. I beheld your power and your glory. The Bible says the eye has not seen nor the mind imagined how incredible heaven is. So let your mind go wild. And it's better than that. And David said, in desperate situations, because my soul thirsts for you, I create a picture of how God is and I worship him. I overcome my circumstances and my problems by seeing God in the best way I can. Number two, in verses 3-5, David makes a decision to express praise to the Lord. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live. Folks, this is not a one-night stand. David did not treat God as a prostitute and a hooker. He said, I will do this every day of my life. This is a divine, intimate relationship forever. The family that provided the husband for Jenna last night, they had one child. And they said a popular phrase in their family was one and done. Okay? And so every completion of something significant in his life, they had to enjoy to the fullest because it was one and done. David didn't say one and done. David said, God, I just don't come to you when I have a need. I just don't come to you when I want something. This is my relationship with you every day of my life. I will praise you every day. Praise isn't something that we do for God. God does not have an ego that needs to be soothed. We praise God for what He has done for us. Dave found personal satisfaction in expressing this praise to the Lord. The third decision that David made is he decided to meditate on the Lord. That's in verse 6. He contemplated God every night. Not only would he praise God every day, but he would meditate on God every night. The Hebrew term rendered meditate here means to utter, to devise, to plot. It's based actually on a verb that originally denoted a low sound that was often associated with the cooing of a dove or the growling of a lion over its prey. Imagine me at Babb Steakhouse in Montana. And they bring out to me a 24-ounce ribeye steak after a 17-mile hike. This actually happened. And I had the smaller steak at the table. Joe Avila got a 32-ounce porterhouse. Okay? Can you imagine they brought that out and they put it in front of us? I practiced the verb. I looked at it, I closed my eyes, and I said, That's the impression I get of what David did every night as he meditated on the truth and the promises of God. He looked at it, and he said, It satisfies me. David then decided to sing for joy in verses 7 and 8. Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings. I stay close to you. Your right hand upholds me. Even though David is running from Absalom, he doesn't run from God. David said, though I have been run out of my home, I have not been run out of the protection of the wings of my God. David did not do what the entire city of Jerusalem did 800 or 900 years later. You remember Jesus, his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, and then he ends up on a hillside looking down at the city? And the scripture says that Jesus wept as he looked out over the city and he said, Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. How oft I would have gathered you as a mother hen gathers her chicks under her wings and cared for you, and yet you would not. David said, I do. I may be running from my son Absalom, but I know where to run under the wings of my Savior. I am holding. Sally's Bruce would have had to have given David $1. Remember Bruce? Before he went to heaven, if he caught you holding hands with your spouse out in the parking lot, he would come up and give you $1 because he loved to see affection demonstrated in public. He would have had to have given David $1 for holding the hand of his Savior. And then last of all, David decided to rejoice in the midst of his circumstances. He decided to rejoice in God. Verses 9 through 11. But the king will rejoice, not in his power, not in his palace, not in his prosperity. He said, I will rejoice in my God. That's who I'll rejoice in. Lewis said in another book, God designed the human machine to run on Himself. God Himself is the fuel of our spirit that we are designed to burn. It's the food for our spirits that we are designed to feed upon. There is no other. That is why it's just no good asking God to make us happy in our own way without bothering about a relationship. God cannot give us a happiness and a peace apart from Himself, because it's not going to be found there. There is no such thing. Let me wrap this up. I want to move you 800 years after David wrote this. I want you to hear the words of Jesus Himself. And I want to show you the close comparison of the two. David said, "My soul thirsts for you." And Jesus in John 7 verse 37 says, "On the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, 'If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink.'" We Americans are a people who love to celebrate our holidays. I do not think anybody would argue that probably our three biggest holidays that we celebrate in this country are Christmas, Thanksgiving, and the 4th of July. The Jewish people also love to celebrate their holidays in the Old Testament. They called their holidays feasts. I like that. There were three great national feasts in the Jewish religious calendar. The first was the Feast of the Passover, the second was known as the Feast of Pentecost, and the third was known as the Feast of the Tabernacles. Now we know from this reading that Jesus was speaking here at the Feast of the Tabernacles in John 7. This was a very high, happy, holy day in the life of the Jewish people. The Feast of the Tabernacles was kind of like Christmas, Thanksgiving, and the 4th of July all rolled up into one. During the feast, the high priest would go to the pool of Siloam, where Jesus later did some healing, if you'll remember. And the high priest would take a golden pitcher, dip it into the water of the pool, carry it back to the temple. There he would pour the water out on the altar of sacrifice. And at that moment, the Levites would blow their trumpets, and the great crowd who was present would yell out loudly, "With joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation." That's recorded in Isaiah 12:3, if you need proof. There would be leaping and dancing and shouting and singing, and great hallelujahs would fill the air. And it was right at that moment, at the climax of this great feast, that Jesus Himself stood up in the crowd and with a royal voice He cried out, "If anyone thirsts, don't go to the pool of Siloam and don't come to the altar of sacrifice. Come to me and drink." You see, Jesus realized that for many generations now, the Jewish people had been drinking from the river of ritual religion. After this day was over, they would go back to their same fears, their same faults, their same failures, their same old frustrations. And what was wrong with that crowd then? What was wrong with that crowd then is what is wrong with many today. We show up at church on Sundays, we get our little dose of worship, and we go back to our regular routine of Monday through Saturday, to the same old stuff. They're drawing water from a wrong well. Too often we drink from the worldly well instead of the well of eternal life that is found in Jesus Christ. If you would like to gain a spiritual thirst, then listen to our Lord's words once again. He says to you and me today, as He said to all the Jews in John chapter 7, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink." In order to gain a spiritual thirst, we must desire God's spiritual water. Jesus said, "I am the water of life, springs of living water I will give to you. If anyone thirsts, let him come." I love the word "anyone." That means you or me. It means you and me. We can find God if we want to find Him. But notice it's addressed to those who recognize they are thirsty. The problem is many don't realize that they're thirsty for God. Jesus shares this promise from the Bible: "Those who drink of the water I will give them, they will never thirst again." God will lead us to the water. But just like we can take a horse to water, we can't make him drink. We must choose that ourselves. If you want to be filled, drink. Drink from the faucet of life, not from the drain of this world. Don't rely on your feelings and what feels good, but rely on God's promises and truths. For the things of this world in the end will not satisfy. They will drain the life out of us and we'll end up parched and dehydrated. We have different kind of pipes in our houses. Some carry fresh water. Some carry what we call backwater. There's two drains, two pipes that you and I can drink from spiritually. One is fresh water. That's the water of life that comes from Jesus Himself. The other is the drain of the cesspool of this world. Do you know what you end up getting when you suck on the wrong drain? I don't need to say it, do I? You get the best this world has to offer, and it ain't very good. Or we can choose to satisfy our thirst by coming to the living water, by coming to Jesus. The invitation today, David wrote in Psalm 34:8, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good." If our lives are satisfying, Piper says, God will be glorified. I wonder how much glory He's getting today. Where are you and I drawing our satisfaction from? It's only found in intimate, daily relationship with Him. Let's pray. Dear Lord, there's a strong possibility. There's a few folks in this congregation today who've never personally entered into a relationship with You. And I trust at this very moment they've heard enough today to realize that maybe the craving that drew them here today, the craving as a result of circumstances of life, just as David had circumstances, that which drew them here today is so that they could have this moment in time to consider a personal, intimate relationship, not with Tim Rowland, not with New Hope Church, but Father, with Jesus Christ, Your Son, the One who says, if you're thirsty, come to Me, and I'll give you rivers of living water flowing through you. I pray right now they'll invite You to come live in their life. No magic formula, no special ritual prayer, just an honest confession. Says, Lord, I need You. I've lived apart from You, and that makes me a sinner. But You love me anyway, and I'm ready to love You back. I'm ready to start this thing called a journey of faith. Lord, for the vast majority of us, I know we're believers. But maybe we've been satisfying our thirst at the wrong fountain. And so I pray, Lord, that we will recognize that the desire that we have that brings satisfaction is one that we can only find in You, so that when we face the tough moments of life, there's not a radical change. Like Jim Brobst in the loss of his wife just a little over a week ago, it has been a steady journey for his family. Not devastated, sorrowful, yes, but not devastated. Hope-filled, encouraged, strengthened. That only happens, though, in this divine, daily, intimate relationship with You. Help us at New Hope, Father, to provide the kind of environment where that quality of life is discovered, maintained, and advanced. Not for our good, though it will be good for us, but because we want Your glory to be revealed to the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Have a good afternoon, guys. Books up here. Find a pen if you'd like. Post it.